Luke 6 and verse 26, the Bible said in the word of the Lord, amen, whoa! Somebody shout, that's what you'd say to a mule. The church said, hee-haw. Wow! Unto you. Come on, somebody. Would all men speak well of you? For so did your fathers, the false prophets that were before you. Somebody shout, you just might be a false prophet. If everybody always likes what you got to say when you preach. Watch me preach.
Come on.
God said, prophet of God, you'll show yourself to the heathen king, the backslidden king, and I'll send rain. See, we think if we just pray in the altars, God's going to send them out. We show up on the first Tuesday of every May, and we call it, amen, glory to God, International Prayer Day, and whatever it is, come on somebody, where we all get around and we get on the steps of the courthouse, come on somebody, and some read prayers off the papers, and some sing, come on somebody, hallelujah, but then they go pig out afterwards, amen, some things ain't going to come forth except they come through fasting and prayer. Come on somebody, Mark 9:29, would to God, I wonder how many participate on a national day of fasting. Do you know the first Thanksgiving that President Abraham Lincoln, our 16th president, amen, issued forth on October the 3rd, I believe it was 1800s. Anyhow, you just search Google it, you can find out. Praise the Lord God. Amen. But he said, the first Thursday of November, I want to set aside as a day of thanksgiving unto God because he's been so merciful toward us as a nation and we have been so sinful. And he called for a time of fasting and praying. Ain't it amazing how Thanksgiving has now become a time of feasting? But he set it aside to begin with as a day of fasting and prayer. And what kind of prayer? Somebody say repent. Turning to God and turning from sin. That's what he was talking about. That's the reason he said, let's set it aside. Amen. And give thanks unto God. He's been so merciful to us because, hallelujah, amen, we have sinned against him, but he showed his mercy to us. We ought to repent and turn to him with fasting and prayer. Amen. Hallelujah. And God has sent this prophet to this heathen king, this backslidden leader. And I promise you, it was a message of repentance coming out of his mouth. And we're about to see what he preached. And God says, I'll stop the famine. I'll send the rain. Somebody shout, it's going to take more than prayer to bring revival. It's going to take preachers preaching right about the wrong. You can pray all day, but if somebody don't get in the pulpit and cry out against the sin and the culture they live in and be bold and declare to the face of its leaders, come on somebody, hallelujah, this is what God says, hallelujah, you can stand and you can think now that you're God, hallelujah, and you're Supreme Court, and shove God to the side, and now you redefine what marriage is, hallelujah, and you say when life begins and when it don't, hallelujah, glory to God, until the preacher preaches again. Come on, the Bible said in Micah 3 and 8, I love this scripture, he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to declare unto Judah her sin. Somebody said the Holy Ghost was upon him. That's what Michael the prophet said. He said to preach against sin. We got puppets of the devil packing out big crowds with mega churches on TV rubbing elbows in the presence of the famous down at Hollywood Central. Amen, glory to God. And Oprah loves most of them because Oprah believes you can go to heaven many ways. You can go through Jesus. You can go through Buddha. You can go through all. You can go through yourself after all. You can meditate and go on the Ponderosa Pine. My God, and get a river. Amen, that'll get you to heaven. She thinks there's all kind of ways. But Jesus said in John 14 and 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come unto the Father but by me. Somebody shout, it's written in red. Jesus the Christ said that. Hello, somebody shout, they go one way. And it's Jesus. Somebody say, it's your way, not your way. Come on. Hallelujah. Amen. And they preach stuff that's so attractive. It's the Trinity gospel of me, I, and mine. their titles and their subjects that they take off to. Come on, somebody. It's always about what God is going to do for you, yours, and ours. It's that me gospel. Me. And preachers, if not careful, have become, in the generation we live in, manipulators, even witches. Come on, somebody. Though they got charisma in their delivery. Amen. You'll find them prophesying because they know it generates some merchandise. Because hell don't sell, but heaven does. That's why they make so many movies about heaven, and we still got people walk out of the theater live like hell. Oh, at the top of the Christian charts, hallelujah, you'll see it celebrated with Dove Awards. It's always songs about mercy and songs about grace and songs about redemption. And somebody shout, that's the Bible, and we need all of it. Amen. But how come you don't hear songs about judgment and the wrath to come hitting the top of the charts? Because that don't sell. We got so many puppets of the devil posing as preachers. Come on, somebody. They all the wood they got in their delivery of their message, it ain't the holy wood. It's Hollywood. It's glamour. Come on, somebody. Amen. Send your $1,000 donation, and I will send you this prosperity cross, or cloth. And the church said, hallelujah. Amen. Ain't nothing but hot air. That's all that is. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. See, if you're not obeying God with the tithe and the offering, come on, somebody, bring it into the storehouse to begin with. Malachi 3:10. Praise the Lord God. You can put that green prosperity cloth in your purse, in your wallet. Amen. It may look good, but it ain't going to bring you no money. If that thing was so anointed, they wouldn't be trying to get you to send an offering in to get it. They keep it. Hello? They can't preach. They can't. They can quote scriptures every now and then. They can't preach. All they can do is show you testimonies. Yeah. And usually it's about money. Yeah. Money miracles. Yeah. Money miracles. Yeah, they'll show you healing miracles. Come on, somebody. Read your Bible. 1 Peter 2 talks about Satan doing lying signs and wonders. The Bible said in Deuteronomy 13, in verse 13, if a false prophet or a dreamer of dreams rises among you, give you a sign or wonder, amen, and it leads you after other gods. God said, don't hearken unto that false prophet or dreamer of dreams, amen, because the Lord your God, amen, has come to prove you to see whether you're going to follow him or not. Did you hear what he said? Even if the false prophet comes along, the witch, come on, somebody, the little peeper, the little creeper, come on, that I spake of earlier, amen, he gives you a sign or wonder, somebody shall give you a good word, something you was wanting to hear, and all of a sudden, what they said actually comes to pass. But come on, hear the Holy Ghost. If it don't lead you to this book, if it don't lead you to the Lord of this word, come on, I don't care if it comes to pass 100 times. It can be coming to pass and causing you to go astray. Say, hello? I'm going to expose this one. I'm going to get into 1 Kings 18 and the rest of it, so y'all just hold on. Hallelujah. There's this floating type faith thing that's going around. It's really becoming popular. If you haven't heard it, you will. It's these, I call them glory gluttons. Glory. Oh, everything's the glory. Luke 5, when Jesus manifested himself and Peter experienced his glory, he fell down at Jesus' knees and said, depart from me, for I'm a sinful man. In Isaiah chapter 6, amen, when God's glory filled the temple after a king named Uzziah, whose name means pride. Come on, somebody. When pride got killed and pride died, and God's glory, his train filled the temple, amen, glory, the pillars of that place begin to shake. Amen. And you hear Isaiah saying, woe is unto me. I'm a man of unclean lips, dwelling in the midst of a people of unclean lips. Somebody shout, when the glory of God shows up, the first thing he's going to do is prick, amen, the heart where sin is. He's going to expose the sin. Come on and call people from it in repentance. This here, glory gluttons. They talk about the glory of God so superficially, not supernaturally, though they claim supernatural. Super Dad's even a TV show that's got that name in it. Some of you can see it right now. They spend a lot of time with that on there. They have all kind of false prophets on that program. I quit watching it. Wow, man. They believe anything. It don't matter what it is. As long as it's glory. Hello? I know a minister that was on one of the programs not long ago that I personally knew. We didn't even have a ministry when I did have one. It used to come where I was at years ago, but now have crowds flocking to their ministry. Come on. And here's what they teach. They talk about glory portals. Personal portals. Portal means door. In other words, every one of us have been born with a personal portal to the glory of God. It's yours and no other. And all you have to do is acknowledge that portal, that it exists. And after a while, God's going to open it, and you're going to get caught in. And you're going to have revelations of this and that. And they'll even take pictures of their ministry, amen, and you'll see little blurs. Or little images of something in the capturing of the photo. There's the glory. And by breathe, y'all get mighty quiet. I'm having me a ball. Praise God. Hallelujah. I love putting the devil in his place. Come on, exposing him and casting him out. Come on, somebody. John 10:9, Jesus said, I am the door. Yeah. No man, come on, somebody, can enter in except he come through me. And if he comes in any other door, he's a liar and is a thief, and ain't no truth in it. Look at your neighbor and say, you were not born with some personal door to your God's glory, and nobody else can have that one but you. In Luke chapter 9, Jesus is on top of the mountain. We call it the mountain of transfiguration. He stands there, and as he prays in verse 29, his garments become white and glistering. Come on, somebody. His countenance is altered. He's standing there in his glory. Elias or Elijah, amen, and Moses appear with him. Elijah represents the saints that will be caught up without going to the grave. And Moses, who died, will represent the saints that will rise first from the grave when he appears in his glory. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. They talk. Somebody shout, they're talking. As Jesus is manifesting his glory. Somebody shout, this is the glory. Jesus is seeing his glory. And the only message Jesus is talking with Elijah and Moses about, verse 31, how about his decease, about how he's going to die in Jerusalem in a few days. Amen. And suffer. Amen. Of the scribes and the Pharisees. And how God, his Father, was going to raise him from the dead 3 days later. Somebody shout, he talked about the cross. He spoke about his cross. He spoke about his death. Friend, I want you to know, somebody shout, the glory is connected to the cross of Jesus. Hallelujah. For the preacher, not the cross, and them that perish is foolishness, but unto us that are saved, it is the power of God. You want to know the glory of God? You'll find it at the foot of a bloody cross, where a bloody Christ, the Lamb of God, laid down his life that he might redeem us from our sin. Somebody shout, that's the glory. Is the glory, but these puppets of the devil, amen, all they can share is experiences. I call them hashtag prophets. You see them on Facebook, hashtag it everywhere. All they do is share their experiences. They can't teach the Bible. They can't preach from the Bible. Their experience becomes truth rather than scripture. Hello? They got so much glory, they can get divorced 100 times and remarry. They got so much glory. Hello? Some of you watch some of them. Somebody's getting revelations right there. Hello? Come on, somebody. Look at your neighbor and say, you're in the room of a prophet. This is what we do. Years ago, everybody called me evangelist, and I lived up under that title, amen, because it's found in Ephesians 4, verses 11, because that's the more popular thing to be called, and it is one of, Amen. The fivefold. It is the third one. It's the evangelist. Come on, somebody. Billy Graham's an evangelist. Come on, church. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? But God called me years ago, and I didn't share it a lot of times because a lot of the people I was associated around, amen, trembled when they heard the word prophet. Come on, somebody. I've had people even attack me on the internet and come against me, even denominationally. Come on, anybody hear the Holy Ghost? Why? Because they say, how can you be a prophet? I said, the same way God called you to be a pastor, the same way God called Billy Graham to be an evangelist. What's a prophet? Does he talk about just the future? Yeah, eventually I will get on that somewhere in the way. Amen. But here's the major theme of a prophet, and we're about to find out. They repaired the altars. Come on, somebody. God sends the prophet to the lost sheep of his own house. God, amen, sends the prophet not to just show people about tomorrow, but to call them back to discarded values of the past. Expose the devil. He sends us to Ahabs.
Come on.
He sends us to leaders so the rain can come. Hello? We'll preach on stuff other people wouldn't even dare or touch. That's why we can't stay in one place a long, long time. Hello? Sometimes we even call to walk alone. Because of it. Somebody shout, prophets are weird people. They sometimes I just hello. I'm not a good counselor. I have people all the time want me to counsel. I'm not a good counselor. Hello? I'm just not. Because when I see something, BAM!
Come on. Sound like good counseling to me.
Yeah. It's just quit drawing. There it is.
Amen.
That's it. I don't go over good sometimes.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen.